Joining us now to weigh in on the statement of PCGG chief, or of the PCGG chief, is former PCGG commissioner Ruben Carranza. Attorney Carranza, good afternoon to you. Thanks for joining us today and welcome to the program.
Thank you for having me.
All right. So we heard from the PCGG chair saying it could take 7 years. Well, that's what he thinks, that it's going to take 7 years to finally resolve all pending Ilgan Well cases against the Marcos family. First of all, let's start with that. Your thoughts on that statement alone?
It's going to take forever to resolve PCGG cases if Marcos Jr., president of the Philippines, does not respect the independence of the PCGG, and because it's a presidential commission on good government. It is a contradiction, and that's why I think it's important for Congress to, in fact, consider an independent commission on good government focused on the Marcoses and their cronies, rather than abolishing the PCGG. If they were really honest, if they really cared about resolving cases against the Marcos family and their cronies, that's what they should do. They should ensure the independence of the PCGG, make sure the PCGG is funded, and most importantly, make sure that the commissioners and the chairperson of the PCGG are completely independent of the Marcos family and are competent in doing what the PCGG has to do.
Well, from the current PCGG chair, I read one statement, and this is not verbatim, that he thinks that the president will respect the PCGG and will leave the PCGG alone. You don't believe so?
He wasn't a president before, and the family never respected the PCGG. They tried to undermine the commission every step of the way, including all the way to the Supreme Court. That's the reason why the previous conviction of Imelda Marcos for corruption was overturned, because they actually went all the way to the Supreme Court and found strings to pull there, which indicates the power that they still have. Now, all the more reason for them to use that power now that it's the power of the presidency. So it's not true that he will be hands off. Even as we speak, I am certain that the Marcos family is trying to end the efforts of the Philippine government to go after their ill-gotten wealth, their unpaid taxes, and their criminal cases.
Hmm. Well, what's your proof for saying that, Ruben?
The fact that the BIR, for example, has not acted on the tax liability of Marcos Jr., of Ferdinand Marcos Sr.'s estate, and that's the liability of the Marcos family. The fact that the Marcos government has not enforced the liability of, for example, Herminio Dicini's family. There is a Supreme Court judgment that became final in 2021. It's now 2022. Marcos Jr. took an oath to enforce decisions of the Supreme Court, part of the law of the land. And one decision says that his cousin, the Dicini family, must pay 1 billion pesos, must return 1 billion pesos. So there are several decisions of the courts, of the Supreme Court particularly, that the president of the Philippines must enforce. He hasn't done anything about that.
Mm. But when you let's talk about what can be recovered, right? So there are 87 pending cases. The total is about 125 billion pesos. That's only as far as the local cases are concerned. I understand that in New York, there's about $70 million still. And then 50 billion. I'm not sure if that's in pesos or in dollars. Is it $50 billion in potential profit from the sale of recovered assets, Ruben?
That's probably 50 billion pesos at this point,
yeah,
because some of the assets have been sold. But you're correct. The New York assets alone are very substantial. And the Marcos family has continued to intervene in the efforts of the PCGG to recover those paintings, to recover some of the assets that are still pending litigation in New York. But not only that, of the 87 cases you mentioned, for example, at least one of those cases involves paintings that Imelda Marcos has tried to hide, has tried to keep away from the PCGG. And that's an example of just how brazen the Marcos family can be in preventing the recovery of ill-gotten assets. So the PCGG has a lot more to do. Remember, in 2013, the PCGG found assets in the US, which are now the subject of litigation in New York, paintings by Monet worth about $18 million in 2013. That means 27 years after its creation, there were still ill-gotten assets being found and being recovered.
Ruben? Yeah, okay. So, but as you say that, you know, the PCGG is also not without fault. Through the years, there have also been allegations of corruption that hounded the commission. How do you think that factored in when we talk about the timeline, why it's taking this long to recover the ill-gotten wealth?
You're absolutely correct. And it's not, therefore, a question of whether the institution should exist, but whether you appoint the correct people, the competent people, the people with enough integrity to do what has to be done, because we're not talking here about going after ordinary criminals. If there's corruption in the police force in going after ordinary criminals, I'm certain there is even worse corruption in going after the most corrupt family in Philippine history. So it's not a question of the institution, it's a question of who you appoint as commissioners in the PCGG. And over the last couple of decades in which the PCGG has existed, you've had a few credible commissioners, chairmen, Longa, Yorak, even during the administration of Noynoy Aquino. And it's really a matter of finding the right people to do the right thing.
Mm. But when you hear the PCGG commissioner, the current one, say that it could take, he thinks that it's 7 years, and that's a year after the life span of this administration ends. How do you make sense of that? What does that tell you?
Is he assuming then that the Marcos family will delay these PCGG cases even more, the ones pending in the Supreme Court, the ones pending before the Sandigan Bayan involving several other Marcos cronies? Because it doesn't make sense for a PCGG chairperson, for a PCGG official to say that this is how long it will take. It has taken long because the Marcoses themselves have made sure that the cases are delayed so that the political atmosphere will be favorable to them. And that's what they've been doing over several decades. It's not simply the PCGG being led by persons who may not necessarily be the best persons to be there, but it's also about the Marcoses deliberately delaying cases so that they continue to languish in court until a new president is elected who will help them, give them impunity.
Knowing what you know, let's call it Ruben. For the cases here in the Philippines, which totals up to 125 billion pesos, how much of that do you think can still be recovered? What are the fighting chances there?
All of it can be recovered, and some of it can be recovered through settlements. The Marcos family is actually capable of offering a settlement because they have in the past, even when I was PCGG commissioner, Imelda Marcos brought James Lin, one of her American lawyers, to the PCGG to meet with Heidi Yorak. And I was there in the commission when she asked James Lin to meet with the PCGG. That means they were open, they were willing, they were aware that they could settle these cases and settle them fairly. And one of the very basic demands that at least at that time when I was in the PCGG under Heidi Yorak that we asked them to do was to make a full disclosure of their assets abroad so that we can start negotiations over what should be returned and what should be taxed. They never came back. So it just shows how unwilling the Marcoses are to actually settle and resolve these cases. That's why it will take even more than 7 years, because you now have a family in power who will simply want to keep their ill-gotten wealth and even try to get back ill-gotten wealth that is being kept for them by their cronies.
So when you hear the current PCGG commissioner saying that, okay, that's the figure, 125 billion pesos, and in so many words saying hindi lahat yan talo, hindi lahat yan panalo, may iba dyan talo. Again, what do you glean from that kind of a statement coming from the current PCGG chair? Kung this is true, yeah, what you're saying, that there is another way here, and that's through settlement. Go ahead.
No, this defeatism is precisely what leads to defeat. If we had that attitude in 2003, we would not have recovered $680 million from Switzerland. We fought in the Supreme Court and we won against the Marcos family because we believed in the possibility of winning cases against the Marcoses, even with all the power they have. And even with all the power that Marcos Jr. has right now, it is possible for a presidential commission on good government, especially if it's given independence and resources by Congress, to actually once and for all recover ill-gotten assets from the Marcos family. It is possible. We've shown it possible. We've done it before. It can be done.
Let's go to the cases in NYC totaling to about $70 million. What's the latest there? Do you have any word regarding that?
The Arelma case involves about $40 million in a bank account created by a Panamanian company who's one of the beneficiaries of whom is Marcos Jr. And the Marcoses have continued to claim those assets, even as there are other claimants, including victims of the Marcos dictatorship. So that's still pending. There's another case involving the assets that were recovered from the aide of Imelda Marcos, Vilma Bautista, who was convicted of tax fraud. And the Marcoses are still also trying to lay a claim to that. They've continued to retain lawyers in the United States, which is also precisely why Marcos Jr. wanted to ensure that he is given immunity by the United States if and when he visits the United States, because he knows that these cases are pending, and not only these two cases in New York, but also the judgment against his family in Hawaii that can be enforced by lawyers in the U.S. against him personally.
I want to read to you the statement of the current PCGG chair when he talked about the pending cases there in New York. He says, we have bright prospects of more recoveries in the coming years. Meron po tayong $70 million in New York. We are working on final judgment. When you talk about New York, it's bright prospects for the current PCGG chair. When we talk about the local cases here in the country, prospects not so bright. What does that tell you?
It shows that when courts function and when courts are independent and when lawyers do what they have to do in a competent way, then the PCGG can recover assets, ill-gotten assets of the Marcos family.
Finally, Ruben, of course, we're talking about this while we're still in the middle of the pandemic, while economic recovery remains to be a pipe dream, while more and more people just really fell below the poverty line because of this pandemic. Why should it be relevant to keep on talking about this as we continue to view the situation that I just mentioned to you?
Because the single biggest set of cases of corruption in the Philippines are these cases involving the Marcos family. And if, you know, one family owes at least 23 billion pesos in taxes and at most 203 billion pesos in taxes plus penalties, you can imagine how much all that money, if it's actually collected and enforced by the executive branch, who is now headed by a Marcos, all that money can actually lift millions of people out of poverty, can send kids back to decent schools, can ensure that hospitals can take care of people dying in a pandemic or even outside of a pandemic. And that's what the Marcoses did to the Philippines. They impoverished the country so much that even 36 years after they were ousted, Filipinos are still suffering because of them.
And we're going to have to leave it at that. Former PCGG Commissioner Ruben Carranza, thank you for joining us this afternoon. Really appreciate it. Thanks again.
Thank you.